welcome to Awake Ones. I'm Sally Poinsett-Nash.
I'm Alexandra Wendman.
And I'm Lorraine Flaherty.
And today we're going to be talking about Mary Magdalene and the matriarchy. So, Lorraine, you've been over in France.
I have.
Doing a bit of a recce. There's a Mary Magdalene pilgrimage coming up in July. And I know nothing about, well, I know very little. Nothing is probably a bit of sleep. I know very little about Mary Magdalene, and do you want to just talk to the viewers about your experiences that you've had over in France and the retreat that's coming up and the whole Magdalene connection?
Yeah, well, having been raised Catholic, so the story of Mary Magdalene that we're taught at school was that she was a prostitute and that she was somebody that was supposed to have anointed Jesus' feet with oil, and that he forgave her her sins, forgave her from being a prostitute, and that she became one of his followers and became part of the entourage that would have travelled around with him. And of course, quite early on, I started doing my own research because I didn't believe a lot of the stuff that I was being told, so I pretty much figured that that story might have been fabricated as well. And it turned out that actually she wasn't a prostitute at all. And in fact, it was 2016, the church, the Vatican actually put out a declaration to say that not only was she not a prostitute, but that she was actually the beloved disciple, that she was working alongside Jesus, and that she had been a really important figure in that whole history. And I sensed that there was more to the story, even as a kid. So I really researched the early life of Jesus and Mary Magdalene. And the general gist that I got was that she was his equal, and that she was somebody that they were both actually involved with sacred magic, and that they were both introduced at an early age to sacred mystery schools, and that they were high level initiates, both of them. And they'd probably been to Egypt, and we know Jesus travelled in India, I'm not sure whether she actually went there. But it became really apparent in the research that I did as well that she was actually his partner, his wife, and that they had been working together, and that they had probably also been working on sex magic, that the Eros Gamos, so sacred sex magic, more akin to Tantra, and that they would have had at least one, if not more, children. And I was, aware of this probably 12, 13, and of course, when I tried to talk to people about it, they thought I was crazy. They thought I was completely mad. And it's only, it was in the 1980s, where the Holy Blood and Holy Grail came out, and they revealed that was a truth that they'd discovered. And it was all linked to a priest in Rennes-le-Château in the south of France, Father Saunier, who'd made loads of interesting discoveries that nobody quite knows exactly what he discovered, but in a tomb that was linked to the Templars, he found something. There was a document that he found in the baptismal, wooden baptismal font, and he found a document that was a bit of a map that led him to some treasure. And then he became extraordinarily rich. And to this day, they don't know whether he found treasure that was valuable, or whether he was blackmailing the church with a secret. And the story goes that it was information about Mary Magdalene and what had happened. And we know that historically, after the crucifixion, whatever that was, and you know, whatever really happened on that day, that Mary Magdalene travelled to France because it wasn't safe for her and her disciples. You know, the church went one way with Peter. She had to leave. So she travelled to France with some of the disciples and potentially her child and children, and that she stayed in various places. And so the location that we went to, Al and I went there in July last year, and then went back again this year, was to go back and explore some of the places where she lived. And there are some caves where they stayed, which are not advertised. Nobody tells you where they are. And the message is that if you're meant to find it, you'll find it, or them. And we very little help. They kept turning up, didn't they, and saying, oh, I'll help you, or I'll show you. And we were told that we were going to have to climb mountains and wade through rivers. And
you needed proper rock climbing.
And you needed proper rock climbing. And it was, you know, it was going to be really be, a testing journey. And we literally just, all the people disappeared. So we followed our own guidance and found it just really easily. We stumbled upon it. And so I went back again this time, and I think there was a part of me this time thinking, was it really there? Did we really find it that easily? But I was able to go back again. So, you know, there's a lot of secrecy, there's a lot of, essentially a lot of fabrication about her story. It's amazing that it's starting to come back to life. What are some of the things that you picked up
about her? Obviously, yeah, being raised a Catholic as well, on the opposite side of the world, the whole poor and virgin thing in the Catholic Church, I never bought it as a child, and I remember being really young and not ever understanding what this imbalance was between men and women. Like, why? Because I went to a Catholic school, my whole world was done, like, kind of built around the Catholic Church, and there was all this shame put on women and put on the feminine. And I remember being really little, and I remember, you know, going to church and seeing the boys up there on the altar serving the wine and doing the Eucharist and wearing their kind of altar service dresses, and thinking, oh, I'd love to do that. I'd love to be part of that. And then asking my teacher, well, can I be an altar server? And the teacher saying, oh, no, 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 girls can't do that. Only boys can do that. And being absolutely crestfallen and thinking, that's not right. And then other little things that they would do, you know, girls had to have a smaller playing field and we got less things and it was all wrapped up in the church. And then when they started talking about, you know, Mother Mary as this virginal, pure, and then Mary Magdalene as the prostitute, and these were the only two feminine role models in pretty much all of the scripture that we were taught, it really didn't wash with me. And I don't think to the level of detail that Laurie, I didn't go and kind of start exploring it. I don't think I knew that there were many other options out there for me until I kind of grew up and left that Catholic school. I went to a Church of England school, and then I, you know, shortly after I left school, moved to London and then began my whole spiritual journey. But when we went to, it was probably Dan Brown's stuff that originally, even though it wasn't his original research.
No, he took that from
but
the
yeah, he got
the
it
Templar
from that,
Revelation as well.
The Templar Revelation as well. And so he, that kind of, there were bits in that that made me go, oh, I need to find out the original, the real story. And then I started reading like Tom Kenyon's book and Judy Sartori's channeled work, and then Lars Moore, the O manuscript, and then ended up subsequently, we met Lars last year and I interviewed him. And then that was just before we got guided to go to France on this pilgrimage. And then it was like, I didn't realize that I was being guided through my whole spiritual awakening, my whole spiritual journey. I didn't quite, even myself, realize the importance of the fact that I'm a woman and the fact that I'm feminine. Like, I channeled precious wisdom, I had all this stuff happening I was channeling, and obviously it's all feminine energy, it's intuition, I deal with the realm of magic and intuition and the dreamy side of life and all of that, but even there was a part of me that didn't realize the importance of the fact that I'm a woman, like, until it was really weird. It was like, I sort of went, oh, and then I got given this message about a diamond ray and a diamond flame, and that in a channeled message that I was a carrier of this diamond flame, and I still didn't really know what it meant, and I still don't think I know the whole of what it means. But when we went to France, the energy is alive with Mary Magdalene in that place. Like, I don't know how I know it, but I know unequivocally that she was there, and we were guided by her energy, by her spirit, the entire time we were there, to the point where we found places that the locals keep hidden and sacred and secret, and they don't tell anyone how to get there. And if you're meant to find these places, you'll be guided. And we found sacred churches built on old ley lines and standing stones, one of which is said to be connected with Isis, the goddess Isis, the Egyptian goddess, from ancient Roman times. And in that place, you know, we actually were given channeled messages, each of us individually. And then, you know, I was kind of sitting back going, I'm not going to do my thing. I'm just going to sit back here and let everyone else go up behind the altar. And then got pushed to the altar and sort of asked, can I open to channel? Because I was asked to deliver a message. And it was absolutely her energy. And I don't, you know, maybe I met her in a lifetime. I don't know. But I just know that it was her. And then we found the caves. And one of the things that really blew me away was when we were in the caves, and we were sitting in the caves, and we came together with a group of people that we kept being united with, that were traveling separately to us, and kept having these visions of us all in white, you know, back in the day, perhaps, you know, doing sacred ceremony in those caves. But while we were in, I think it was the middle, was it the middle cave, the womb one, the womb-like yeah. cave, I looked up and I could see her face in the wall of the cave. This huge rock had almost created a shrine to her, naturally sort of formed. But it would have been her in her later years as an older her. But I just knew it was her showing us her face in the rock. And I took photos of it. I must dig them out. And then we also looked up, and a lot of us could see an image in the rock of Mary Magdalene and Yeshua together in the rock, in the actual formation of the rock. Loads of people were pointing it out. But it was amazing, because there were these three caves, and they each seemed to represent the head, the heart, and the womb, and the, you know, the mind-body-spirit connection. But I mean, the whole time we were there, it was just, it's like there's a simmering up to the surface at the moment on this planet of the feminine energy, but it's a truth. It's a level of truth that's been either hidden or oppressed. I think some of it's been hidden deliberately from us. And in my experience and in my opinion, the access to the feminine, which isn't whether you're a man or a woman, it's the access to your intuition, to your soul, to your inner knowing, to your inner guidance system, is true power. And it's true empowerment. And if you have access to your true power and to your truth, you can't be controlled. And so it's my belief that there are forces on this planet, or people on this planet, that have deliberately hidden that power and that truth from us so that they can make money from it, probably in the simplest terms, and they can control. And that's very sad to me. It makes me really upset. But also really excited that it's returning and the balance is coming in. Because what we have now with the feminine, it's not going to turn around and oppress the masculine, or it's not going to turn around and go, right, now women are running the show and we're going to oppress the men. It's coming into this beautiful, like Laurie said, sacred marriage, sacred union, Eros Gamos, of the balance of the masculine and feminine within each of us, and therefore then the balance of the masculine and feminine in the counterparts of what we have on this planet, you know. And there, you know, the Templar revelation even pointed out that Jesus had female disciples. It makes sense to me that there would have been pairs of them, you know, the two by two. So
I did some work a while ago with one of the mystery schools, which most of them are closed, but there is one that's open, and I recall them saying something about Mary. You know, she was, Mary Magdalene was a great author and a storyteller, and there were several books that she had written, which when the church came into play, those books were removed and destroyed, but they had copies of them in the monastery, the Tibetan monastery still, because they keep a record of everything that's happened. Is that something that you're aware of?
Oh yeah. And you know, this is something that I'm pretty convinced that the vaults of the Vatican are full of, you know, this information we're just not given access to. And we know that when the Bible was put together, that there was the Gospel of Mary, and this would have been Mary Magdalene's writings, and there were many other Gospels. So it was the Gospel of Thomas and lots of other ones, and the Gospel of, I think, James, Jesus' brother, has also written.
Strategically omitted.
Yeah, and so those were just taken out, you know, at one of the big meetings that happened. I'm not sure if it was the Nicene Creed, but one of the that was put together at that time. Deleted everything that might weaken the status and the male roles, and so women were literally just put into that place. As you say, it was either to be revered as pure and holy and a virgin, which, again, just nonsense really, and to be seen as wolves. So there was no real place for women to be accepted, and I think that, you know, even Michelangelo, when he painted the Last Supper, you know, there was a lot of controversy about the painting because many scholars tried to convince people that it was John the Beloved that was sat next to Jesus, and it's clearly, I mean, it's clearly a woman in the picture, and it was he was clearly defining Mary Magdalene, who the church have now admitted was the beloved disciple.
Even the shape of them is forming an M.
It forms an M. Yeah. So he was trying to, even at that point, he was trying to reveal that secret. He was trying to reveal that truth. And what was really interesting, even when they made the declaration about her not being a whore, you know, it was put out, but it was put out in such a small way that I don't think many people, to this day, people that I talk to, still don't know the church did that. They didn't really advertise it completely.
Do you think the confusion came around the fact that there are so many Marys in the Bible, and there, you know, in the New Testament, there are so many references to Mary, but actually it was a very common name at that time.
Yeah, Mary and Miriam.
Miriam.
And again, the names cross over, and I think even in some of the stories, in some of the writings, they called Mary Miriam. The names were often interchangeable. Yeah, and some of the stories talk about the fact that perhaps Mary, Miriam, and Lazarus may have been siblings, which would have made sense because Lazarus was the one that Jesus was supposed to have raised from the dead.
Or was it Martha? Mary Martha?
Oh, sorry, Mary Martha. Yeah. And so, there are conflicting stories, yeah, and we don't know which ones are the actual true stories. But even significant that she was the one that was supposed to have found him at the end of the third day, she was the one that went to the tomb, and traditionally in those days, it would have only been a wife or somebody that was a relative or somebody that was very closely linked to a person who would have had access. She was the one who sat at the tomb. So again, there were kind of clues in the writings, and when she was supposed to have anointed him with spikenard, that was one of the most expensive oils. And so we know that actually she came from quite a wealthy family. She was quite a well-to-do person who decided to come and follow him, and then became an equal. And I'm pretty sure that part of what has led to them suppressing it was that the message that she took when she went off to France, when she continued the teachings, was going to be based on more of what Jesus, as the teacher, not the one that was claimed as a divinity, because he never said that. He never claimed that he was the only son of God. He was claiming that we all connected. And I think her message, and the message that her disciples took with them, was going to be based on the real teachings, that that was the truth, and that didn't really fit with the church's interpretation, where Jesus became deity and therefore could be worshipped, and therefore they built the whole church around this idea that this, you know, and of course it then becomes suffering as well, because we're led to believe that he died, and therefore we have to carry guilt for our sins.
And then the church has to be the intermediary, don't they?
And the church
becomes the intermediary. You have to pay them to pray for you, and then there's you don't have that grace.
So it became a very masculine, male-dominated environment that became about the accumulation of wealth and money and status and goods. You know, they created their entire own city and police force.
Then you go forward in history a little bit, and you have all the burning of the witches, which is basically the burning of wise women.
Exactly.
Those that knew the truth, and those that were using the magic, but through love.
They've just released the Mary Magdalene movie. Mm. Did you go and see it?
Yeah.
You went and saw it. I mean, how closely does that relate to your own experiences of it? I mean, what are your thoughts around it as a movie and as information?
Mixed.
So
a bit of a film review.
So I went with trepidation because I suspected that it was probably going to follow the biblical story, and that just frustrated me. But actually, what was so hilarious was that the first probably 30 or 40 minutes of the film was like somebody had just gone in and just made up this completely random story that had nothing to do with anything biblical or Mary Magdalene or anything that I've ever read about her. You know, they had her living in this fishing village, and her sisters were out fishing every day, and her family wanted to marry her off to this dude who was a widow and children, and she didn't want to marry him. And then, you know, Jesus turns up, and they've tried to, you know, get demons out of her, and they send him in as a healer, and that's why she leaves, because her family is so awful. It's just absolute codswallop. And I nearly left. I mean, I was so frustrated with it, and I know loads of people left the cinema at the beginning of the film. Anyway, because I was with these guys, I thought, no, I'll carry on, I'll give it a go. And but when she actually did leave and started to follow Jesus, he then treated her as an equal, which was a bit annoying for the male disciples because it was a very male-dominated era, so they weren't very happy about it. And actually, the more it went on, some of it didn't really match, but the more it went on, the more it became obvious that actually they really were talking about her message. And where the other disciples wanted war, and they wanted to fight their way through, and they wanted to be warriors, she just kept saying, but he's talking about peace. You know, which bit are you not hearing?
Don't give the whole plot of the movie away.
People know.
Even though they know the plot.
They know the plot of the movie. But anyway,
I don't know the plot.
I wasn't going to say what happened at the end. But so actually, when it got to the end, I was really moved, and the message was really powerful. And so if you can rent it, just fast forward for about half an hour, and then so it moved me. I cried at the end, and I never cry. So yeah.
I think whoever the people that made the movie, I think they sort of did it really well, because they obviously wanted to present the truth,
yeah,
but not in a way that would really rock the boat. I think they played it a bit safe with the storyline, and you know, kept it quite loose in the beginning, but I do think that they managed to weave in that she was a really important figure, and you know, they did. I loved, we were talking about afterwards, and I loved the way that they were calling Yeshua, they call him Jesus, I think, in the film, but they were calling him the healer, which would have been really true. I mean, it's what we do, it's what all of us, if we want to, can access. We all have that gift. And they were really portraying that you know, it was possible that that's what he was showing. And it made it more kind of, you know, less of a deity and less of a, you know,
someone. He was a real man.
He was a real person. And he walked the earth. He was an initiate. It's just sort of made it simple to follow, but to get to the truth in a really gentle kind of way. And then I loved, like, they did actually... I'm not going to say it because I don't want to spoil the end.
And I wanted, like...
Yeah, there were some pleasant surprises interwoven in it, you know.
And some truths, actually. Yeah. There were some truths.
Yeah, it was gently done. And I thought the cinematography was lovely.
Yes, it's beautiful.
Fabulous. This episode is Mary Magdalene and the matriarchy. So should we focus more now on the matriarchy side of things? I have to be careful not to say the monarchy.
I got Buckingham Palace behind us.
Exactly.
Well, I mean, it is interesting, even with that, with the monarchy, that right now we have a female queen, and we have, obviously a female queen, but we have a female prime minister. So women are now stepping into the roles that men used to play, although I'm not sure, sometimes some of the women that get into power and politics actually, you know, mistake the position and actually try to be like men in the role, which I don't think is always helpful. But I think we are seeing a rise in women stepping into positions of power, and I think we have to be aware that, you know, the different skills I think that women have to men is their ability to, I think, use, as you said, intuition and, you know, more of a feeling way through a problem rather than just left brain logic, here's a problem, here's a solution, you know, finding ways to navigate through that space. And I think it's really important, and it is important also to balance and respect the male and female aspects within everybody. Like you said, it's not about feminism and saying, oh yeah, you know, just bring the women in and get the men out of the way. I think we have to learn to work together, and I think that's the importance of the new
I think even feminism, it's about that, it's about both. both. Obviously there's an extreme version of it, which, you know, that's not what feminism is. That's not what it's intended to be.
I think there's been some extreme versions in the past where where, you know, and it's not about being a man hater or suppressing the male. I mean, I think in early times, you know, if you look right back to prehistory, in a lot of indigenous societies, it was the women that ran things. The women were the rulers, and then, you know, maybe that went too far the other way, and then it's flipped. And now we don't want it to flip back. We want it to be in the middle.
When you look at ancient Egypt, I think they had it right for a lot of the time. Maybe not in the later kind of dynastic kind of years, or further down the line, they sort of started to lose it when the priests of Amun kind of went a bit crazy with their power, and around the time of Tutankhamun and Akhenaten. But I think they really got it in the beginning, and I think they had it where, you know, this idea that being kind and gentle is a weakness has been something I've grappled with my whole life, because and I think the three of us are the same, because we're very empathic. And I think that being empathic and intuitive can actually be a real strength of your gift, and especially when it comes to things like negotiation. I mean, there's a peaceful way of doing things. It doesn't all have to be war and fighting, and I think that the Egyptians knew that and they got it. And one of the most powerful things about a man and a woman in partnership is if a woman feels loved and if a woman feels safe, then the man will be 100% supported to be the best that he can be. But a woman has to feel held and has to feel secure and loved. She has to feel loved. And that is what I think sacred partnership is all about. Then a woman will be a force to be reckoned with in the support of the man, in him moving forward and doing what he has to do. So I think that this idea of that men have to be powerful by suppressing women has completely missed the mark. I think that if anything, they're gonna like just run out of hot air at some point. You know, it's all bluster and no oomph. You know, the oomph comes from the woman. It comes from the nurturing. It comes from the supporting. It comes from the lifting. It comes from the cherishing. And I think that's what we're learning. And likewise, when women, like Laurie was saying, women in business have had to try to be like men, and then you just get this loggerhead. You know, it's almost like it needs to feel cradled, like two spoons kind of sitting together. But I think that the Egyptians really had it in the, ruling, and you have it with the counterparts, with Isis and Osiris and Horus and Hathor. It's beautiful. They were showing on the Pyramid Code. I was watching it last night on Netflix. It's great. It's actually like it's all based around Robert Gavell and Graham Hancock's kind of research around the truth of what the pyramids were, and what all the temples were used for and everything. And they, you know, the depiction of the crown of Upper and Lower Egypt, and they talk about, well, it's Upper and Lower Egypt, or it's masculine and feminine. But it was actually showing it as the glands of the body. The crown that looks like a bottle upside down on the head is actually the thymus gland, and the other one like that is the womb. And it is the importance of love and the womb that actually keeps the kingdom supported. And that's the feminine. The womb is the feminine. It's the Holy Grail. It's the chalice. And that's the secret of the Grail. It wasn't a cup. It was the woman. It was the sacred. The beloved. Does that make sense?
Kind of.
I've been around the house.
I'm thinking of it more sort of within, you know, within a man and a woman. There was also that. It's not just man and woman. It's a partnership. It's a partnership. How I see it, within each individual.
It's left and right brain. It's intuition and logic coming together. They both need to live in sacred union within us first, and then you'll meet, you know, then you may meet your counterpart. Right. Then, you know, that's why it works so well.
And skipping back to Mary, our friend Mary. I was over, my heritage is Maltese. My family, on my grandmother's side, are Maltese. And when I was over there, I was very drawn to the Knights of Templar and that whole side of Malta. But there was also a Mary connection, Mary Magdalene connection there. Just personal curiosity. What was that?
Yeah, well, I'm sure she probably went there as well, because I think she did travel around the Mediterranean to actually get down through into France. She had to travel by down through all these different countries. And because there were links, so I think that the Cathars and the Knights Templars, I think, were advocates of her. I think that was the path. I think that they were still following the teachings that she had put out there. So it's why we would have seen them being suppressed, and why they would have been, because the Cathars were burned at the stake, as we know, they were gotten rid of because they refused to acknowledge the current church's teachings. You know, they said, we would rather stay true to what we believe, we would rather die than actually turn the other way. So I think they were following the thread, the Templars, and so all of those places, and it's the Knights of Malta as well, yeah, were a particular strain of it. And Malta is a very, it's very Catholic, it's a very sort of spiritual centre, and it is, there's a lot to the Mother, Virgin Mary, and Magdalene. But you'd also find in many churches in and around amongst Europe, which I think is probably indications of the fact that she was there, many sightings of what they call Black Madonnas. And we had a bit of an adventure in France when we were there last year, where we'd been told that there was a Black Madonna in one of the churches, and that it was somewhere in that region, I think it was Limoux, that we'd found out. So we went on this mad chase. And it was quite, we kept finding churches and then they were shut and we were banging on, please let us in, we've come all the way from England, we have to find the Black Madonna.
But we found
white, a white one.
Gold, red, and then finally black.
And then finally we found the Black Madonna, and obviously it was quite a surprise when we got there, because in fact it was a replica, because the original one was broken or stolen or both. So it is a replica, but she wasn't actually black, she was just tanned.
Yeah.
You know, she just had darker, kind of more olive skin, which probably make a lot of sense, bearing in mind that she was living in the Middle East. Probably a lot more factual. And but even this, there was a lot of controversy around these. But there's definitely some in Spain. There are many in different regions of France,
Poland.
I know that there's one in Italy in a little church near Lake Maggiore. So she pops up, and there's a real link between the worship of the Black Madonna and the Isis cult, which comes back to the original Egyptian teachings. And I think that there's a lot of similarities. So, yeah.
So for anyone, I mean, I know you're off to Egypt next, at the time of filming, next week. So I'm sure we'll have episodes on Egypt before we have another Mary Magdalene showing up. But you've got the pilgrimage in July.
Yes.
For anyone who does have that connection, that Mary Magdalene connection, or they want to come on the pilgrimage, you know, pilgrimage to me sounds very religious. And I know it isn't that. You know, what can people expect? You know, what would being on this retreat, you know, what are you going to do? Can you just tell me, I'd like to know, tell the viewers a bit about what this is?
It's about finding the truth, but finding your truth, really, finding what resonates with you. And we sort of, we follow, it's like the Cathar Trail is mainly where we got guided, which is also very connected to her. So we go to some of the places where she was said to have been, and usually it's wherever we're guided to go, and then we find out, oh, like our car got towed and we ended up in another place, and we're like, oh, well, this is where the actual final document was signed that sent the Cathars to their burning. So it's all like, follow the spidey senses and end up there, but we do have a loose itinerary. But we sort of leave people in these sacred sites to have their own experience as well, because even though we come together as a group and we will have group shares and meditations and guided journeys, and Laurie might do some past life stuff as well to unlock some of your own knowledge about the places, it's really about having your own experience and kind of feeling into those places and seeing different people resonate with different areas. Like I know that when we were in Rennes Le Chateau, I had a really emotional experience there, sat on the wall, and you know.
So the wall where Al was sat, Al's got her own YouTube channel, and her show is the Alexandra Wenman Show. Look, plugging it for you.
Thanks, darling.
And she recently started putting up some of her channeled material. And I was watching the Mary Magdalene one, and you know, for me, I described it as being very out there.
Yeah.
I see you in this capacity,
yeah,
and then you're sat on a wall and you're channeling and you're singing and you're crying.
which is becoming more normal to see. Less out there every time I see it.
It is weird to see.
It is. But sort of after I'd watched it, I was in bed and I was like trying to get to sleep. And I had this, I said to you afterwards, what on earth was this? Because with the Galactic video that had been, it was on the Awake Ones channel, I had this experience where I turned blue and it was where Al...
Lovely shade.
Sharpie blue. And after I'd watched this particular episode, the police turned up.
it's Archangel Michael.
I heard this sort of angelic choir music in my ears for about 2 hours to the point of laying in bed going, stop it. So, you know, when you do channel and you have these experiences, and now that you're sharing them on the internet, you know, they're actually affecting me when I watch them.
That's why I'm feeling like I have to put them out. It's something, like Laurie knows, for years I've been terrified of sharing myself doing any of it. I've always felt comfortable doing it in a workshop environment, in a small group, but to put them up on video has terrified the bejesus out of me, because it does look weird to people that haven't experienced channeling or seen channeling before. It can look strange sometimes, like my hand will shake or its energy comes through.
And I would agree with all of that, you know, from the perspective of someone watching it going, well, that does look a bit out there.
But it is, from what my guides say,
the impact.
It's incredible. The energy is pure love energy that comes through. The guides that I work with they're working on a higher dimensional vibration, which means they're just light beings of love. Yeah. And it's more like a rush of love. And the words being spoken are relevant, but it's only a tiny part of what's coming through in the actual message. So the songs as well. But it's almost all designed to get us out of the logical mind. So it will make people feel uncomfortable. It will feel a bit weird because it's like, it's not what we're used to, but it's meant to kind of shake you awake. It's meant to make you go, hang on a minute, what's happening to that person? You know, but to feel it. Like, if you see someone channeling, I almost say, you know, even me, don't just sit there and take the message as gospel. It's a two-way conversation. Feel into it. Feel if what's going on feels right for you. And you don't have to receive any of it. Like, I'm just kind of a transmitter, and I never, like, it's very rare that I will plan to go somewhere and sit and channel. And that day on the wall, you know, our friends were singing and channeling, and I was more filming. And then I just kind of thought, oh, I'm just going to sit down and have a little sing. You know, I just thought, you know, because Virginie, our friend, has the most stunning voice. And I literally sat down just to hum, just to sing, just to do some kind of chanting. And this power came up through me, and it was power, and it was feminine, and it started off really beautiful, the words, and it was really loving, and it was return to the mother were the words, return to the mother, and it felt very Magdalene, but it felt more than that. It felt like the goddess, the power coming through me. And then by the time the tears had started, I was in a really deep trance state, and then I felt the energy of all, it felt like souls coming up through me, passing up through me. And Laurie, I wasn't seeing, I was feeling. And it felt very angry, and it had felt like these people had been murdered. And Lorraine, simultaneously, I'll let her share what she saw we were doing this clearing together as part of this group. And it was like the city had sort of opened a doorway into what we now know are caves underneath this place where Cathars and people had been practicing their spirituality. We didn't know when we were sat on that wall that these caves were there, by the way. We just arrived in Rennes Chateau. We hadn't even gone and seen anything yet. And all I felt was, first of all, such a deep sadness, and then blind rage, like hell hath no fury, like a woman scorned, or like the feminine scorned. It was like I was looking out over the vista, which I now know is directly opposite where the Mary Magdalene caves were, had this energy of like, it was like, I'm back and watch out. Like, it was, it felt like that. It felt, she's here. And it felt very Sekhmet Kali,
oh, yeah.
Black Madonna, like, she's powerful. Don't mess with the feminine, because the feminine, you know. So I'll let Laurie share her experience of it, because she was like there holding space and like clearing and observing the whole thing, and I was really in the actual channeling. So I don't know what it looked like, because Andrea stopped filming at that point.
Yeah. Well, I was just kind of watching it, all of this going on, and I wasn't really singing or chanting. I was just feeling my way into the space, and then somebody came up behind me and just tapped me on the shoulder and said, "I think it's time."
Time, Lorraine, to get involved.
Yeah, I think maybe I should be joining in here and doing something.
And it's so, a natural person.
It was actually
a person. Yeah. And so I closed my, and immediately I closed my eyes, and I literally just dropped down, and it was like I dropped down into these caves, underground chambers, tunnels that we only found out about afterwards. And I could see them. I mean, so clearly, I could see the moment where the attack happened, where they'd been living peacefully under there, where they'd been carrying out ceremonies and rituals, ones that had been handed down since the time of Mary Magdalene, and there'd been a whole community that had been living under there, and where some of them were trying to run away to escape, some of them couldn't get out, and there was just massacre. There was just a massacre going on at the time, and a lot of the souls were trapped, they were stuck. And so I think it was kind of between the two of us with the chanting and the singing.
They were predominantly women and children.
And it was mainly women and children, yeah. And so again, it was, you know, about opening up a portal and sending love into the space, and then just gently guiding these souls and saying, it's okay to go home.
It wasn't gentle.
It wasn't well.
It was like
trying to gently.
Yeah.
As where possible, and just between us then holding that space so that they could leave. Because there was a lot of fear, and as you said, anger, and I think the density, the weight of that heavy energy was keeping them trapped, and the frustration of why, you know, why would you do that? These were peace-loving people who weren't bothering anybody, they were only trying to be good, they were living in accordance with nature, they were honouring everything, they saw everything as sacred. So I think there was a huge amount of confusion as to why should these people be treated so brutally. But obviously it's not the truth that some might want to put out there. So it was very powerful to just release them. And yeah, it was very moving. It was very powerful. Very, very moving indeed to participate in that.
And it was directly after it, we went up into Rennes Chateau, we went to Saunier's house, and then we were in like the walls around the property. And Lorraine and I both just got guided into this little, like an alcove kind of bit, where no one else was kind of being guided, like people walk around the gardens. We just got guided into this little place, and there in the ground is the opening of a tunnel, a secret tunnel that's been
one of the subterranean tunnels. And
there
was a light that you could turn on, and it's suddenly you could see this tunnel going right down. Both of us just burst into tears. So, oh my god, that's what we just experienced.
Because I went and sat. We went and sat up on the tower first of all, and then I could see it. Then I could see like this spiral. It was like a spiral of caves going down.
It's
that was like, that's what I saw. And since then, I've had like past life memories surfacing of it. And there was something about what I got from the past life that I had in there was that it was mostly women and children, because they sent the men away, because the women and children, they knew they were being at this point, and the women and children, because they were so innocent of heart, I suppose, and it was easier for them to hold the space of trust that they would be safe. And as we know, everything is energy. If you believe you're protected, then you'll be protected. And what I got was that they'd agreed that they would set up like a protective energetic grid around the cage to protect the women and children. And the men believed that, well, if they find the women and children, they're not going to kill them. Surely they'll come after the men, so that we'll keep you here safe, and then we'll go off.
Yeah.
But some of the men didn't trust that they would be protected and had turned back and to go and check, and it broke the magical protection that they put around them, and then they were discovered. So that was the kind of, that was my past memory that I'd had of it, of being in there and having, like, you know, just slaughter.
So we did clear it, so the energy is much nicer, nicer now. It was much lighter when I went this time versus that first time. So, yeah.
But then we went up Montsegur, and I felt fine walking up there, but we had other members of our group had really, really emotional time climbing that mountain, which was the place of the last cape stand, was the last
one
stronghold.
One of the last strongholds.
So, you know, it's different places will hold different energies for each individual, and it's not always going to be intense and grueling for everybody. But I mean, some of these places you might not particularly have a vision, but sometimes you'll be moved to tears and you won't know why. And it's the same with going to Egypt. You walk into those temples and you're kind of being healed. You're kind of having an exchange of energy with that place. So you're simultaneously healing the earth and then healing yourself. Freezing now.
I know, we're
going
to we're gonna have to wrap because it's cold.
It's now cold.
The sun came out in London today. I think we got a bit excited. So I think if there's one overarching message sort of on the Mary Magdalene and the matriarchy theme from both of you, what would that be?
It's that we all have within us a feminine, gentle, intuitive, loving side, and that it need not be suppressed any longer. It's not a weakness, it's an absolute gift. And we can't live our whole lives in logic and rationality, because what's the point if we don't have beauty and we don't have love and we don't have compassion and we don't have music? What's the point? We need them both working together. And if there's peace within each of us and we can be loving, we need all both sides of us, then peace can be far reaching for everyone in relationship.
I think the message is very clear. Don't believe everything that you read and everything that you're shown. The best way to really know the truth is to explore, to research, and to go with what feels right. Use that feminine intuitive ability that we all have, men and women have it, to find out your truth and stand by that. You know, I feel very proud. I remember a past life as a cape girl, which obviously got triggered there. So, you know, I feel very proud of those souls that stayed absolutely true to what they believed in, that would rather die than change. Thankfully, we don't have to get pushed that far now.
They came down the mountain singing because they refused to
bow down. So I just think find your truth, explore, reach out. If something doesn't seem right to you, if it feels a little bit off, then go seek.
Be like a child, ask questions of everything.
Explore.
So I think if you have any thoughts on this topic or any of our other videos, please leave a comment below. And if you're interested in joining the Mary Magdalene pilgrimage in July, you can find all the details on the Awake Ones website, and the details for that are below and will follow. So
thank you for watching.
Thank you for watching.